Hey fellow tennis nerds, welcome to another Tennis Nerd video. Today I wanted to talk about the pro staffs, the different sizes, different iterations of the pro staffs. I won't go through every version, every generation. I just wanted to briefly illustrate kind of the history of how the pro staff evolved in the last 10-15 years. There's one player who's especially connected to the pro staff, I would say, that's Roger. We just received the news, obviously, that he's undergoing another surgery, another knee surgery, and it looks pretty grim for a player that is now 40 years old. Is he gonna come back? Let's hope so. We're pretty much all hoping so, but it's gonna be pretty tough. And he said as much that he's gonna be gone from the game for many, many months. And so as a small tribute to him, I wanted to talk about the pro staff. Federer is not alone in pushing the pro staff, but he's the guy who's the most connected to this line of rackets. We also have my childhood idol and next Federer coach, Stefan Edberg, used the pro staff 85. Federer did that as well. Jim Courier did that. And famously as well, also Pete Sampras. So many good players connected to the Wilson Pro Staff 85, one of the most iconic frames there is, pretty much. And you can still enjoy it today, and I'm gonna still enjoy it and play with it. I have a review on the channel, but I wanna do an update to that review. I played a lot more tennis now these days, and I can hopefully give it more and do it more justice this time around. But let's have a look. The one I have is a reissue in my hand. I have a St. Vincent as well, unless I sold that. But it looks like this. It's such a beautiful, classy frame. Few things stand out, obviously, to compare to modern frame. This is a 85 square inch racket, so it's very small compared to today's standards. You don't have a lot of sweet spot to hit with. To, you know, be able to play with this and get some stability, you need a lot of weight. That's why it's a very heavy racket, around 340 grams unstrung. The swing weight is pretty manageable. It's very head light, so you still get a swing weight around 330, which is strong, which is pretty decent, so you can still hit with this. It's just make sure that you hit the middle of the very small sweet spot there is. But it's a beautiful playing frame, great stability, plow through. The feeling, especially at the net, is just magical. So if you haven't tried a Pro Staff 85, you have a friend who has one, you can find one online and buy it used or whatever, do it, because it's such a brilliant frame. Anyone interested in tennis rackets should have played with this, or you know, collect one, because it's such a great frame. PVS system on the sides, that's very typical for Pro Staff, the perimeter weighting system, and that gives it a nice plow through, a little bit higher twist weight, nice thin beam. It has this braided graphite and Kevlar composite construction, 80% and 20%. So just a brilliant frame, the 17 millimeter beam. I think it's 17, I'm not mistaken. Just a fantastic frame used by so many legends of the game: Edberg, Sampras, Federer, Courier, so many Grand Slam winners. Early on, Federer felt like he wanted a bit of a bigger head size. He wanted to get a bit more free spin, a bit more forgiveness from the frame, and that led him to the Pro Staff 90 that looks like this. There are many versions. I did a review of the Pro Staff 90, the first edition, a while back. This one, the K-Factor Pro Staff 90, is actually the one that's, you know, reportedly the closest to the one Federer used, because Federer used a Pro Stock Pro Staff 90, had a slightly different drill pattern, slightly different construction, I guess. You have to correct me if I'm wrong here, but what I heard is that this one is the closest you can find to what he actually used, the K-Factor. This is when they made it pretty close in the retail version to the frame he used. And this is a beast of a frame, high stiffness, 90 square inches, 1619 pattern, very head light, 12 points head light, and just, you know, a tank through the ball, but the head size is still small. You still need to put in a lot of work to connect well with this frame. But when you do, it's a brilliant frame. And if you've seen Federer play with the Pro Staff 97 he uses today, and this one, I would argue that his forehand was better with this one. He got more kind of this liquid whip that they called it. He had this beautiful flow and motion on his forehand that's allowed by the mid-size head size. It's just, you know, allows you more whip to generate more racket head speed. And I know a lot of club players still enjoy a smaller head size to get a bit more racket head speed. The issue is, when you're defending, the forgiveness of this frame, the power level is low, and it's easy to hit outside the center of the frame. So it's not an easy racket to use, especially if you hit with a lot of topspin, like most players do today, and the game is faster. more spin oriented. It's a different game, but still beautiful frame if you like attacking, a fun frame to use. And this is what Federer used for most of his career until he moved to the RF 97 autograph. But before I move into that, we can go what's in between these two frames, the 85 that Sampras used, to what they wanted him to use after he had retired, which was the KPS, it's called, the K Pro Staff 88. So this is also an icon. This one is super heavy, developed together with Sampras, who used a racket closing in on 400 grams. This is a bit lower, 365 grams with strings. And I'm gonna string this up and I'm gonna review these rackets in a video as well coming up. But 1619 pattern, 12.3 ounces unstrung, 9 points headlight. So a very heavy swing weight frame, a little bit less headlight balance, just a tank, an absolute tank, more than the other frames I've talked about so far. And a very nice frame, but very demanding. Obviously 88 square inches is still extremely difficult to use in most circumstances. And I think that's why Sampras in the end went for a Babolat Pure Storm Tour, which I've reviewed on this channel in another video. There's one video about Sampras racket, one review of this classic Pure Storm. So he needed a bigger head size. He went all the way to 98 from 85. And in between, he tried the 88, but it wasn't really enough. Those 3 square inches didn't make enough of an impact. He needed to do what Fed did. And I think in the end, he regret not doing it earlier. And I talk about this in the Sampras video, that he would have liked to make the switch earlier. He would have gotten more power, more forgiveness, still some good control thanks to polyester strings. But in the end, he stayed with the 85 for his entire professional career. And after he tried this for a while, and then he ended up with the Pure Storm Tour. But this is a fun frame for you who like a heavy, heavy frame and can control it. So I'm gonna string this up and try it coming soon. So now we've gone through the mid-size, the 85, the 90 that Federer used for most of his career, the 88 Sampras Special Edition. There was a 95 as well, and that they've had for a while with a thinner beam. It was the 60, so the Pro Staff 60. There's the 61 95 that I've talked about in other videos, and I will mention here as well. But there's also the 60 and 95 that has the lower stiffness, still a very thin beam, 1619 pattern. Yeah, it felt like it needed weight to be more stable. I know Dolgopolov used the original version. I never liked it as much. It was a little bit more flexible, not as stable, not as much plow through. And they did persist with this model, you know, maybe until 2011-12, something like that. And I had that version, but it was a little bit unstable, didn't have enough power really, similar to the 6-1. The 6-1 95 still remains a top choice for pros today, while the 6-0 is much more rare and you won't see it as much. So that model had a more of a resemblance of the 85, but as soon as you change any specs with a racket, you're going to have a different performance from it. And if you add 10 square inches, it's a completely different racket whatsoever. You can't just smack on a bigger head size with the same specs. It's not going to play the way you intended to. So any small change, whether how incremental it is going to affect how the racket plays. That's good to keep in mind. So the 96095 wasn't my favorite. If there are any fans of that, please let me know in the comments below. The 6195, however, is the one I've used the most out of these frames. I've used the Encode mainly. Still, I find it too demanding today, but I know there's so many fans of this. Someone requested that I do a video about what frames can I move to if I like this one, but it's a little bit too demanding. What's a modern equivalent of the 6195? And I'll get to that because I know there are a large number of fans of the 1618 pattern or the 1820, which is this one. And it's a great frame used by so many players. I talked about it before. Kohlschreiber, Lajovic, Del Potro, Edmund, Dan Evans, so many players on the Pro Tour use the 6195 today. And there's a reason for it. It's an attacking weapon for a 95 square inch head size. It's still pretty powerful thanks to the 22 millimeter beam and the high stiffness. Just a tank of a frame, but still a little bit too demanding for my game and for most happy amateurs out there in the club level of tennis. And then we move up to the 97. This is Roger Federer's autograph version that I've designed in a custom paint designed by my son Aiden, who wanted to, you know, make it similar to an old Porsche racing green with the silver. There's also a leather grip here, kind of mimicking the seats. He's a car enthusiast, so that's why he went with this paint job. I think it came out pretty well. And I also have the tennis nerd in text here with an emoji. You can do that with the Wilson custom program. And this frame, more forgiveness than the old pro staffs. More power, a little bit more of everything, but you can't whip the frame as much. It's less maneuverable. It feels a little bit stiffer on the arm. The maneuverability, you know, it goes down when you add thickness to the beam, when you add hedge size. There's also foam filling, which makes the racket more stable and solid, but still will slow it down when you swing it. So Federer's forehand didn't look quite as dangerous with this one. Although he led him to winning three Grand Slams, even with this new frame. But it took him a while to switch, and I think he was frustrated for a while during the process. If you remember 2013-14, around there when he made the switch, it took him a while to actually groove with the frame. And, you know, he started with the Pro Staff 85, then the Pro Staff 90 for most of his career. And then around those years, he made a huge leap to kind of get more power on his shots, get a bit more forgiveness, be able to hit that one-handed backhand against the heavy topspin of players like Rafa, for example. So in the end, it was a good change. It made him win more titles, more slams. But as you can see, you know, comparing the 90 to what he used, it was quite a drastic change. Especially if you're a pro, a change of this kind of measure takes a long time. It takes a long time to get used to groove with that. I mean, if I play with a frame for 1 week straight, which is rare, let's say I play 5-6 times with just one racket, I feel completely at home with this racket and I'm playing much better tennis. And I have a feeling I don't want to pick up other rackets after that because I'm grooving with the frame, most likely. But it's not kind of my life. I try rackets. It's been that way and I'll keep doing it. And I want to give you the best racket and string and whatever information you need to take your tennis to the next level, but at the detriment to my own tennis, because I definitely feel when you make a switch all the time to new frames, whether it's within a week, a month, or a few weeks or hours on the court, it does take some time to get used to the frame. And for a pro player that makes a living from tennis, this change is huge. They have hit millions of tennis balls with one frame and suddenly they add 7 square inches, beam thickness, stiffness, everything. So he made it look pretty easy in the after a while, but it was a pretty frustrating shift for Federer to move to the Pro Staff RF97. But the idea is to string this up with the KPS and the 85 and do a video hitting with these frames to come, if you like it. The Pro Staff journey didn't end there. They're obviously the Pro Staff 97, that's the lighter version of Federer's racket, not used by many pros. I think Dimitrov uses the same old as Fed, but with his kind of string pattern that he likes, 18-17. But otherwise, there are not that many pros that use the Pro Staff 97, although it's a decent frame. It kind of lands in between that it doesn't give you enough power to be potent. But it's more maneuverable, more kind of arm friendly than the RF 97, but you lack a little bit of power. But some players love it. Some players don't, but I haven't seen any pros actually use this frame yet. I think we will see in the future young players that have made the switch and playing with this frame now. But recently I reviewed this one, the Pro Staff 100, the biggest Pro Staff you'll find. And this is not only a Pro Staff, it's a 6-1 Pro Staff. So it has the PVS, has the same shape as the 6195 in the throat part, as you can see. But just a bit more forgiveness, lower weight, 305 grams, easier to swing, more open pattern, 16, 19, 18, 20, just easier to play with and use in general. Not quite as stable, not quite as solid and controlled as this one, but obviously a more maneuverable, easy to use version. So this is where the Pro Staff is now, has the iconic stripes. It's a frame I really enjoyed when I tested it. I keep playing with it. I'm not sure if I'm making a switch. Probably playing a tournament locally here in a few weeks. And I have no idea what racket I should use. If I should use my soft drive, if I should use this Pro Staff, or the new IGA Swiatek that I like, or even my old Prestige MPs. that I have. So I have a few rackets to consider now. Maybe I get a new one for review that I have to use during the tournament. I've never played a tournament with just one racket, so we'll see how this goes. I might be using a new racket every round, which I did some years back, but yeah, we'll see. I'm not so much in it for winning a lot of matches. I need to do this thing also when I play serious competitive tennis. I always find out something about the racket, about something in match situations and so on. So those are my thoughts about the pro staffs going from the 85, Fed, Edberg, Sampras, Courier to the latest one, the most user friendly, the most spin friendly, the Pro Staff 100. It's been a journey, it's been a long ride. There's so many fans of the pro staffs for a good reason. They're good attacking weapons, excellent at the net, nice stability, good crisp feel. If you like a kind of attacking weapon, if you play a style anywhere similar to Roger, I think you'll enjoy a Pro Staff. So there's so many good versions of the Pro Staff, and I've enjoyed all of them over the years. The 88, the 100 I'm enjoying now, the 90 that Fed was most famous for, his Federer's new 97, and the classic, the 85. All great. All really nice to hit and play, and I'll make a video where I hit with these in the near future so you get some footage as well, but I need to string them up first. That's all for this one. I hope you found it entertaining, informative, and somewhat useful. Please click like, share, and subscribe. I appreciate if you subscribe because it helps the channel grow. I know there are a lot of you watching who are not subscribed, so I would appreciate if you actually click that subscribe button, no cost at all, of course. Thanks, YouTube. If you want to buy any tennis gear, please check out my links with Tennis Warehouse Europe, tennis only. I get a small commission at no cost to you. And if you want to support my work in the world of tennis, please go to patreon.com/tennisnerd, sign up. It's only like $2 a month. You get unique content every week that's not on YouTube, and it helps to keep Tennis Nerd alive. Well, that's all for this one. Have a nice day, and don't forget to play some tennis.